What's up, Super Nintendos, and welcome to the coziest episode of Nintendo Voice Chat this year, maybe of all time. I'm doing a little goof here with my sweater. I have to actually unzip it because it's very warm. I am Seth Macy. You can call me Roman Candle because I am fired up about this week's episode. We have a lot of guests. We have Marie wearing a 49ers hat. Not that thrilled about, but I don't have really any animosity towards the 49ers. But right here in the studio for segment one, we are joined by Jada Griffin.
Hey.
Industry legend Kat Bailey.
I'm only missing my nice big cup of eggnog so that I can just chill out and relax.
So eggy. And joining us once again, fan favorite Tom Marks.
Hello.
Tom.
Hi.
How you doing, bud?
I'm doing good. I feel like I'm the least cozily dressed here, but
you got a little...
your bow tie is very festive though, and I love it.
The zip-up sweater works very well.
Yeah.
Here, I'll roll down my sleeves. How about that?
No, you don't have to do that. Oh, you do have patches on your arms though. Those are cozy.
Yeah, it's true. Awesome. It's true.
All right. Hey Tom.
Yes.
You reviewed Super Mario RPG.
I did. What a dream come true.
I imagine it was. I have a question for you.
Yeah.
For those of us like myself, who've never played Super Mario RPG, I was hoping you could start by telling us what RPG stands for.
Rocket propelled grenade.
I was going to go with Goomba, but yes, I think that's actually the correct answer. So this is the RPG that sort of start, as far as I can tell, started the like timing based turn based RPGs. It was the one that, it without it, Paper Mario and Mario and Luigi series wouldn't exist, right? And those kind of split off from it. So it's this quirky thing because it's like was made by Square 27 years ago, I believe.
Many moons ago.
Yeah.
1996, I believe.
Yeah, somewhere around there. And so it was, you know, it's this very funny thing where it's like a Final Fantasy developer made Mario turn-based RPG. It's just such a, it's so funny that it exists.
If you don't mind me jumping in, it's quite a remarkable time in Square's history because this was when Square and Nintendo were the best of friends.
Yep.
Ah, yeah,
very close. Yeah, as developers, Square had been working on the NES and the SNES and had produced many Final Fantasy games. And it was assumed that this would continue into the N64 era. And this was kind of the apex of that relationship. Nintendo let them build a Mario RPG. And Nintendo, it should be mentioned, had been trying to make RPGs as a genre happen in the US for a long time. At that point, if you are old enough, maybe you'll remember that Dragon Warrior was a huge presented as a huge deal and then didn't do that well in the US. So then they gave a lot of free copies through Nintendo Power and whatnot. Mario RPG was arguably another attempt to make RPGs happen in the West, and the way they did that was through comedy, very bright and colorful and wonderful graphics, and a action-based push-button timing system that worked pretty well. And this was the last, arguably, game that Square did as friends with Nintendo. Because the year after, Final Fantasy VII comes out and really does make RPGs happen on consoles in America. But then, of course, it was the ultimate betrayal.
Right.
Yeah.
And Sony and Square became best of friends for many, many years after that. Here's your little history lesson.
No, that's...
Thank you.
It's that's great, because awesome. It's such a... It's great to know all that, too, because it is, like I said, it is such a unique game. And so it's cool to know that it's not just this anomaly. Like, it is very representative of sort of its place in time, right? And where it is in games is that it's unique in a lot of different ways.
Yeah, and Mario really owes a lot to Mario RPG because so many of these characters were developed within Mario. Like, with Peach, for example, I mean, she got her frying pan in Mario RPG. Mm-hmm. Bowser, as we know him today, arguably started more in Mario RPG. These characters became more fleshed out. I think Peach in particular really benefits from being more fully written.
Right.
I think.
And like you said, Bowser in this game is, you know, not to go into story spoilers or anything like that, but Bowser is really, the goofy sort of weirdly lovable angry idiot that he has later becomes. Yeah, he's like,
where it started.
He's such a dope, and it's so fun how much of a dope he is.
I have very fond memories of playing Super Mario RPG back in the day, and it's just like to see the glow up that this one got. I cannot wait to spend all my weekend with this game. It's going to be fantastic. Tom, what was your favorite thing like revisiting it? This is obviously also one of your favorite games of all times, if not your favorite game of all time. What was your the best thing for you like revisiting this?
I don't think it's quite my favorite game of all time, but it's very difficult for me to pick that one.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's a tricky one generally. But yes, it is one of my favorites. For anybody who read my preview a few weeks ago, literally, I didn't own this game as a kid, but I memorized the sticker number on the copy that I had my save file from my local video store, and I always made sure to rent that same one. And then when the video store went out of business, I bought that copy from them, and I still own it with the store sticker on it. So
good.
It's a memento from my childhood that I treasure very much. It was great to revisit it. It was super fun. You know, I've wanted to write about games for so long. Literally, play video games for a living was what I wrote on my second grade, what do you want to do when you grow up thing.
Mm-hmm.
And nice. This game was influential from my childhood. That said, it's also so difficult to review a game that you care about this much to a certain extent, because you're more critical of the things you love, I think, a lot of the time, or at least I am. And so I loved seeing one of my favorite things I think they did is they really updated the combat, not drastically, but they added, you know, normally you would just press A to time with an attack or a block. Now there's a more precise time you can press A to get even more damage or even negate damage, right? They added this triple move system where if you string together a bunch of those really good timings, you bring up this gauge and then you can do a super move that has these crazy cutscenes. They did a lot of other things like you can swap party members now on the fly in the middle of combat, and you can even do that when one of your party members is asleep or turned into a mushroom. You can they won't be able to act, but instead you can just swap them out. So combat is this way more complex thing in terms of you don't always need Peach in to heal your team, because when your team gets turned into mushrooms, you can swap her in, and it gives you a little bit more options. But also, from a modern perspective, it's tricky to review a game like this because it is a 27-year-old RPG that was the first of its genre in a couple of ways, with the timing-based stuff, not first RPG ever. I'm not saying that. First to do a lot of these things. And so a lot of parts of it, even with the updates, do feel old, right? Mm-hmm. And that's not, I think, a slight against it necessarily. It's still a lot of fun. It's just it was interesting to me to have played Sea of Stars this year.
Yes.
And see a timing-based RPG combat system that is arguably a lot better than this.
Mm-hmm.
And it come out in the same year, right? And that is, you know, it's hard not to feel like there are parts of this that are going to feel old to people who have never played it before. But that doesn't mean that the package as a whole wasn't still absolutely great. Because like Kat said, one of the things that they really leaned into to make this game appealing was humor and that weirdness that I mentioned. It, you know, I think literally the box or the cartridge and the box art for this says join Mario on a wild RPG role-playing adventure or something like that. They know that this game is strange and is reveling in that. And all of that stuff still totally holds up. And even maybe holds up better in the context of nowadays, where Mario is this much more sort of sterile, protected brand that Nintendo doesn't go out and do stuff this on. You know, you don't have games where Bowser is smooching Mario accidentally anymore. So it's just really, it's a really cool game still. And it was so fun to revisit it.
He is able to give a lot of hugs to Mario and Smash Brothers, though.
That's true.
Lots of hugs there.
Lots of very friendly hugs in that game.
Yes.
Is that the only Bowser on Mario smooch in video gamedom?
I would be willing to bet no, but I can't name another one off the top of my head.
The art that launched.
Oh, I just Googled it, and there's 12,000 million image results.
You're going to have to throw away your computer now, Seth.
Yeah. Well, I've got malware everywhere now. But. So, Tom, you said that you know, it's one of your favorite games. You know, you love this game, and it presented some challenges. But I'm curious because, you know, I'm obviously the protagonist of reality. Having never played this, do you think it will be hard for me to play this for the first time, knowing that so many other games have come after it that have sort of improved upon it?
No, I don't think, and this is one of the reasons I think this remake does still just like, is still great. I don't think it's going to be hard for you to enjoy this game, right? It's okay. It's not like a lot of 30-year-old games where you play it and you're like, this just doesn't function very well anymore. Mm-hmm. Like, a classic example that I love to harp on is GoldenEye. If you handed GoldenEye with an N64 controller to somebody only used to playing Call of Duty, they probably wouldn't get it, right? I think.
Not right off the bat, at least. It would take some time.
Exactly. This is not that. If you're an RPG fan, you can pick this game up and you will enjoy it. It just is that the combat probably won't be, like, the combat itself won't blow you away, probably. Especially if you've played other things like Superstar Saga or, you know, the Paper Mario games or Sea of Stars or whatever. That doesn't mean it's going to disappoint you. It just means that it's, you know, it's the combat itself is not the reason this game will catch you, maybe. But it is a reason you'll enjoy it.
It's very simple by design.
Yes, yeah, it's very simple by design.
It's designed with accessibility in mind. It's baby's first RPG. So, and I don't mean that in a derogatory way.
Sure.
No, I know what you mean. Yeah.
So if RPGs aren't normally your genre and you find them a little intimidating, maybe this is a great entry point.
And they do have a difficulty mode. I didn't play it, but they have an easier difficulty mode. Mm. The game is, in my opinion, not maybe very not hard.
They reworked the timing somewhat to, I would say, be more forgiving. Mm. You can do exact timings, and it sort of holds your hand a little bit, and you're like, okay, well, you can actually block damage and be invincible
right
against enemies, but if you do that enough, it'll go, okay, we're not holding your hand anymore.
Yeah.
You're stepping back a little bit from that, so.
Yeah, it's very nice in that regard, and I appreciate sort of how much it lets, you know, it lets you come in, or what am I trying to say? Like, you can go on the easier route if you want it, if you just want this story. And I think that that goes to show how much, you know, just the combat is not the point. But there is a lot of combat in the game, so you will be engaging with it a lot.
I have
is there any grinding?
So this is a funny thing because it's not random encounters, right? All of the enemies that you can fight are on the battlefield, and you can see them and you can walk into them to fight them or run away from them. And it's not hard to run past a lot of the enemies in this game. But if you do that, you'll be underleveled. So it's not really grinding as much as, like, if you just sort of fight the enemies that you see in front of you and don't really skip a ton of fights, you will be the level you need to be at any given time. It's very well tuned in that regard.
Oh, cool. Okay. I'm one of the only people in the world who actually likes grinding.
You can
grind. Oh, I'm right there with you, relaxing. Seth. I love grinding.
There's plenty to grind, and they did add these sort of like this post game that wasn't in the original that has harder fights that you sort of gives you something to grind towards that maybe the base game doesn't really call for. So there is that, I think, for people who want it, but it's not necessarily it's not required by any means, which I think is the best type of grinding in an RPG, is one where that rewards you if you do want to do that, but does not make it mandatory.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay.
It's very, it's actually quite short.
Yeah. RPG.
And once again, by design, I remember I played it, the first time I played it long, long ago, we were able to beat it, I think, in a weekend. It was not that challenging.
Yeah, depending on your schedule. I think How Long to Beat says it's about like 15 to 20 hours. I beat it in about 12 this time. But again, I've beaten it before, so I knew where a lot of the things were. I knew where to go most of the time.
Who to talk to when you get to a new place.
Exactly, yeah. And so I didn't do quite all of the side stuff. So I think if you're really just enjoying this game, it's probably 15 to 20 hours. And that's maybe not including all the end game stuff.
It's quite the upset that this game even happened. I don't think anybody ever expected a fully 3D remake of Super Mario RPG, especially given kind of its weird history. And an interesting running subplot is Nintendo was weirdly cagey about the studio that was actually developing it. Nobody knew for quite a while until finally it came out, I believe via the credits, that it was Art Piazza. And Art Piazza, if you're not familiar with them, worked on a lot of Dragon Quest games over the years, especially the ports on the Nintendo DS.
And love those so much.
Yeah, they do a really good job. They did a fantastic effing job bringing over Dragon Quest XI to the Nintendo Switch. And surprisingly making it one of the best versions of that particular game. So
yeah, for sure.
And they did a great job with this remake too. I mean, they added post game, like updating the mechanics. They did a very good job with the graphics, from what I can see. It's quite an impressive little package.
Yeah, it is. It's a very good remake for sure. There was some it's so funny. Every time I think that we don't need an updated Switch hardware thing, mm-hmm. I run into a game like this, which doesn't feel like it should have lag issues. And then about a third of the way through the game, the menus in this game have massive frame rate drops time you open any menu. And I just don't get why.
It was like Switch 2 with better CPU that just doesn't have those lag issues.
Yeah, but thankfully and crucially, none of that shows up during combat. So it doesn't ever affect like the actual sort of gameplay timing of things. Mm-hmm. It's just sort of obnoxious. But otherwise, yeah, I think they did a really good job. I'm a little torn on the art, but I do think it looks very nice. I just wish I said this in my review, but like when you compare it to like Live Alive or Link's Awakening, mm-hmm. which took these sort of very interesting angles to how they updated the graphics, this sort of just is like makes it 3D, which I thought was like not bad. They don't do a bad job of it. It just was like a little bit, I wish they had gone a little further, maybe. But again, you get into such weird, murky territory when you're like, I wish they had changed more is like not quite what I'm saying, but, you know, it can be sort of a weird thing to say because I understand the people who just want an updated version of what this game was.
Yeah, well, watching your review, like the scene where you're like running past the bees, it was very like Donkey Kong Country kind of like graphics. Like if they took what we had for Donkey Kong Country on the SNES, and then they just like, hey, we're just gonna up-res this and smooth it out,
right,
and make it look kind of like, that's kind of the vibe I get from this one, which is fine. It's not a bad look, like
I think that the comparison I sort of landed on, and this might be a little bit harsh, is Link Between Worlds, where Link Between Worlds was a sequel to Link to the Past, and Link to the Past had this beautiful style of pixel art, and then Link Between Worlds went to 3D, and the art is like fine, right? Mm-hmm. Compared to that pixel art, it's not really as good looking, but it's a fine looking game. And I think this probably looks a little bit better than Link Between Worlds, kind of comparatively, contextually, but at the same time, it felt similar to me where, you know, the original had sort of a character, a voice to it that just updating it to 3D, I think didn't necessarily capture.
Yeah.
And that doesn't mean it looks bad, it just means that it's sort of, it's a little bit less interesting to me than what that pre-rendered 3D of the original did.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And Tom, what did you end up scoring?
I give it an 8.
Super Mario. Gave it an 8, which is great.
Great.
On the IGN scale. Well, since you're here, Deputy Reviews Editor,
senior,
you actually
now
brought this up.
Whoa.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Nice. That's excellent. So forgive me, senior deputy. Senior. Oh, my God.
You can leave deputy.
I almost called you senior deputy reviews editor.
Yeah.
You were talking about Nintendo's kind of year, and it's been a great year for Nintendo. And I went ahead and put together actually a list of every sort of first party Nintendo game that released this year. And I organized them by score, starting from the lowest. So who can guess what the first entry on this list is going
goodness
to be?
First party? The lowest first party?
I know it, so I can
for it.
This one out.
Oh.
I mean, I edit these.
Yes,
so I know them all.
Oh, gosh.
It was, I'll give you a little
What's
hint.
What's the score?
The score is 4.
Okay.
4?
A 4 for a first party Nintendo. Everybody 1-2 Switch?
Yes, Jada gets it. You get the point. Yep.
I just needed the score.
The most memorable game of the year.
Yes. Yeah.
Everybody.
It was kind of, I think it was the one of the big draws at Gamescom was everybody 1-2 Switch. You could go up and play it live in front of all of Europe. Follow that by, and this one's a little, I almost didn't put on the list because it is a DLC. It's Pokemon Scarlet Violet, Hidden Treasure of Area Zero Part 1, Teal Mask. Not only did it score a 5, but it's a mouthful. That one came out just 2 months ago, September.
Yep.
Detective Pikachu Returns was a 6. Mm. Kirby's Return to Dreamland Deluxe was a 7. WarioWare Move It, also a 7. Advanced Wars 1 and 2 Reboot Camp was an 8. And now we're getting into the high end stuff. And this tells you how much of a crazy year this is. I forgot that this game came out in 2023. Fire Emblem Engage.
Mm-hmm. That was like January, right?
I think. Yeah, it was January 20th.
Yeah.
Yep.
One of the best games of the year.
It was. I need to go back to that game because it's the first Fire Emblem game that I was like, I get it.
It's terrific.
I like. Yeah, it is wonderful, and it's and it came out this year, almost a year ago. So that is followed or tied with Bayonetta Origins, Cereza and the Lost Demon, also got a 9. That came out on St. Patty's Day, so March 17th. Pikmin 4 also got a 9, came out June 21st. Super Mario Wonder, also a 9. Mm-hmm. And then we have two 10s. And Tom, when you mentioned this, I forgot. I mean, the first one, like, one of them's obvious. It's Tears of the King. The only game that actually should be an 11. Because apparently people are getting mad that I like this game so much. Like,
I noticed that. Yeah. Yeah.
You think it's the best game ever? I'm like, yeah. Ew. Like, I also think chocolate's delicious. And I really enjoy like spending time outdoors. Like, it's normal stuff to people of taste like myself. But the other game, they got a 10. Who wants to field this one?
I don't know what this one is.
Ooh. You're all staring at me. Oh my gosh.
Well, I just know it. I put together this data like knows. The other day, so I like know the whole list. Should I?
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah.
It's Metroid Prime Remastered.
Oh, that's right. Yep. We did give a 10 to that one. That was also like January, February, right?
It was February 8th, that one. Yeah. That was the surprise drop too, wasn't it? They're like, and that'll be available this week.
I think it was out that day.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it was out quite quickly. I'm sure that was a major headache for you, Tom, having to organize the review for that one.
I mean, thankfully,
that was Sam, though.
Yeah, I was going to say, thankfully, we had Sam, who's a big Metroid Prime fan. And so it was like, I think it was easier to find somebody for that one right off the bat. Because who doesn't want to review a Metroid game?
Oh, my God.
Another great remake that they did a really fantastic job with. It's a crazy year. Yeah, really good year for Nintendo. Wow.
Yeah.
Oh,
also, also indicative generally of what this year was, though, is that because I did this data where I like looked at every game review that we've like by score by year since we switched to the 10-point scale at the beginning of 2020. Mm-hmm. And this year is really funny in its curve because it's sort of similar to what Nintendo has had, where it's been a very flat year. We've had almost twice as many fours as the second highest number of fours we've given in a year. And that shows where Nintendo has had 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, right? They have run the whole scale. And sort of the whole year has been similar, where it's been a lot along the whole scale. You know, as of last time I checked the numbers, I think we've given like 28% fewer sevens this year than any of the last 3 years.
Yeah.
Take that, meme lords.
Lots of eights this year. Like, it's funny. Like, I go through the comments constantly, Twitter, Instagram, wherever, and we post our review graphics and stuff and our reviews on site. And everybody's like, 8GN. I'm like, that's not the meme, guys.
The other thing is also, like 17 or 18% fewer eights this year than the second lowest year. This is the first year. This is my favorite stat I learned by doing this. It's not news that IGN that we give mostly sevens and eights. I think the entire industry does for a lot of different reasons. We mostly review games people are interested in. Games people are interested in are usually higher budget, which means they usually are generally have a lower floor. There's a lot of things that go into this. Dan Stapleton wrote a really great column all about this. You can go check
which
out.
Everyone should go read. It's really informative.
This is the first year since we switched to the 10-point scale that sevens plus eights did not make up at least 50% of our total game reviews for the year.
That's amazing.
So it's way substantially shifted either towards nines and tens or fours and fives. It was
the highs are higher and the lows are lower.
Exactly.
Yeah. And I wonder how much of that was like 2 years of game development from home.
It makes a lot of sense. I think that it's game developers are min-maxing almost. They're going for the biggest possible hit because games cost so much money to make, and there's just not as much room in the middle.
Yeah.
The messy middle, as it were. So yeah.
I don't remember the last time a first party developer got two tens in a year and then also got a four. Like, that is so interesting to me.
Yeah.
What's funny is everybody 1-2 Switch and Metroid Prime Remaster were just kind of sitting in a warehouse somewhere. They've been done for quite a while. And then they're like, oh, fine, put them out. And the results were so wildly disparate, I have to say.
Oh, you might have just answered why we haven't gotten Twilight Princess and Wind Waker yet, because one of them's a 4 and the other's a 10.
Don't say that. Don't that curse into the world.
Excuse me. How dare you?
I thought he was going with they're both just sitting in a warehouse somewhere waiting.
No, those, like, I love both of those games. I love okay. Wind Waker is a 10 for me. Like, Twilight Princess is probably like an 8.
Okay.
Wind Waker is a 10 all day long. But yeah, it's interesting because a lot of people sort of think like that the review scale is like there's an average, but that's not what the score, like a 5 is not an average game.
Right.
What is it? Okay. Mm-hmm. Or no, 5 is
mediocre.
Yeah.
6 is okay. Whereas, like,
7 is kind of the average game. Cause let's face it. Like most games are good.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's not even that 7 is the average game. It's just that like 7 is the average game we review. Right. And
that's
always
another
also, for the record, 8, we always literally always give more 8s than 7s. The joke is 7s, but like it's always been more 8. Like that's not a new thing. But again, it really has to do with what we pick to review. And one of the reasons it's not saying that this year was far worse. It's saying that the games people were interested in that we chose to review this year ended up flopping more than we expected or more than they usually do. You got things like Redfall and Lord of the Rings Gollum, oof, right? Which were sort of anticipated larger games that totally didn't deliver in the way, you know, usually large budget games
nobody
do.
Nobody thought Gollum was going to deliver.
Well, that's okay. That's fair. But you
but
know
the,
what I mean.
But on the franchise, like a Lord of the Rings franchise type game, you expect a certain level of quality and enjoyment
fair,
out of that.
Fair enough. Whereas, oh, there he is.
There's our little guy. Our little
ring boy.
Our little.
Hey, give me that precious.
And then we also just had, you know, like, I don't think anybody really expected Pokemon to be as much of as rough as it was this year.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. It's been, I think Kat saying devs are min-maxing is probably not too far off.
Yeah, Nintendo is, this is Nintendo's year.
Is this the best Nintendo year?
Oh.
Or is this the top 2017?
I think it does.
This might,
because Odyssey came out at the end of 2017.
I mean, 2017 had Breath of the Wild and Odyssey.
Yeah, but I mean, we got.
And Splatoon.
But we also got Tears of the Kingdom, we got Wonder, we got Pikmin 4, which has just been smashing records for the franchise.
If it's not the best, it's at least second best. It's like the breadth is pretty wild, and there's a lot of great depth in there too. Yeah, the breadth of the wild. So
just saying that, you know, they've got the kingdom on lock, and there's no tears for many of us.
Oh. And I appreciate you making that stretch and not me. But, yeah. I mean, you know, we brought up the subject of reviews because we always get like a good response. So I hope you enjoy like learning about a little bit about the process of reviews. And we are, you know, I definitely didn't get a check for my PlayStation Portal review. I still gave it an 8 because I liked it.
Also, just a real quick note that I don't think enough people know about this. If you go to an IGN review and you go to the score at the bottom, there's a little thing at the bottom that says like review policy. I can't remember the exact words, but there's a little hyperlink at the bottom. Mm-hmm. You can click that if you've never done it before. And we have a full paragraph about what we define each score as very clearly with example games. So if you're ever curious why something is a 7 or a 6 or whatever, you know, obviously it's not a science. It's not math. This is reviewing. This is opinion.
Excuse me. They are numbers. Numbers are math.
Okay, fair. You got me. But you can see exactly how we define a 6 versus a 5 versus a 4 and what goes into that. And we that's not just like pageantry. Like we refer reviewers to that when they're thinking about scores.
Yep.
So there is a lot of information out there too that you can check about kind of how we think about that stuff.
The other thing I'll add to that as well for reviews is because a lot of times people will see the IGN review and it's like, oh, that's IGN score. It's like, yes, it is, but it's also that reviewer's opinion. It's that singular person's opinion. Bigger games like Tears of the Kingdom, obviously multiple people weigh in because these are like these larger games. Like, okay, I think this is a 10 and like, yes, a lot of us agree. This is a 10. This game is immaculate.
Yeah, but even that sort of thing is more like gut checking.
Exactly, yes.
Like review by committee.
Correct.
Yeah.
But I'll say what I'll say for those, if you agree or disagree with a review, look at what the other person, that person has reviewed other than this one game, because you can get a better sense of that reviewer's taste, and that will help you kind of see like, okay, I agree with Tom with his reviews on these games. It makes sense that I like that I agree with his review here, or like, no, I don't like Jada's review on this. What else has she reviewed? Oh, I like that review she did though. But yep. So it's like, it's really about finding the reviewer whose tastes align with yours.
And some people are really know genres really well.
Yes.
Interestingly enough, I know sports genres and also RPGs. Stella did an incredible job with the Modern Warfare 3.
I agree.
Her review, she's amazing at shooters. Really, really, really good. So it's helpful to know if you are a big fan of a particular genre, finding the writers that you really want to follow and seeing what their opinions are, because maybe they'll match yours. So
this may surprise you because it's not even my department, but I actually think a lot about our reviews and how, not saying that there's anything wrong with it, but when someone's like, oh, you guys gave this a 7 and it's not even an average game. I think we're not communicating that well enough to the audience, because we're telling them they need to go and find out why we did it like this. And I always think, like, how could we improve our messaging around that? And then also to Jada's point, like maybe we need to all be a little more bombastic as personalities so that people know exactly. Oh, Kat reviewed this game, and Kat knows everything about sports games, so this is an opinion that matters.
I always know I'm NBA a very bombastic personality.
Very much. Yeah, right. I always encourage our reviewers to kind of respond in the comments, and I always encourage our users to ask questions in the review. If you have a question about why somebody felt like something like that, I read through these comments, and if I see something for Kat or Tom or Seth or anybody, and it's a well-worded question, you're not just calling the review trash, I will ping them and be like, hey, go hop in and like maybe answer this question. It could be really good. So you can always, and if you don't know what their tags, you want to ping them directly, you can just ping me in the comment system at Jade Arena.
Yeah.
Always.
That's a good one to do. And I just also wanted to add that I can't speak for anyone else, but when I'm reviewing a game, I'm reviewing it from the point of view of the guy who didn't work in the game industry for, 40 years of my life, who just liked playing video games. And I'm putting out my honest to God opinion. At first, I was always worried that I was going to put out the wrong opinion. Like the first couple of reviews I did, I'm like, what if I get this wrong? But now I'm just like, no, this is exactly how I don't have that trepidation anymore, that anxiety. So yeah, like when you read a review from me, I can say like that is legitimately how I feel. And if you and I were talking in a house together at a party, perhaps enjoying like a bucket of jungle juice, because kids don't drink, alcohol is bad. But if we were hanging out, I would give you the same opinion that I write down, except for it wouldn't have Dan and Tom's fingerprints on it, making my words better. Thank you for editing my reviews, is what I'm saying.
My pleasure.
Excellent. Does anyone else have anything else they would like to add? Because I could just talk about cool review stuff all day.
Yes.
Fun to me.
Go play Super Mario RPG.
Okay. People can play that right now, actually, because the show comes out on Friday mornings. And the game is out November 17th, which is
my birthday.
The day.
Ooh.
Oh, what? For real?
Yeah, tomorrow's my birthday.
Happy birthday. Oh, my God. Well, Friday, today?
Yeah, today,
happy birthday to Jada. Happy birthday. You're 21 now. You can go drink.
That
is so exciting.
I can go get that jungle juice you were talking about.
You can go get that jungle.
Don't drink, children.
I'll bring the pineapple and the mangoes to dump in there.
And the apple juice and then the pear juice. You just get all the juices. That's what jungle juice is. You just grab all your favorite juices and mix them together.
It is exactly right. And then you have a fun party where you throw frisbees at the beach and make sand castles. That's not true. Awesome. Tom, thank you for coming into the city today, braving the dystopian hellscape that is San Francisco. So you can talk about Super Mario RPG.
My pleasure.
Another one of the great games of 2023.
Mm-hmm.
I'm super stoked on this one. So, all right, we're going to come back and we're going to eat some food. Oh, wait. No, everyone else is going to eat some food.
Aww.
I'm just going to sit here. Maybe I'll go get a snack. Maybe I'll grab a nutritious apple upstairs. Yeah, we've got some treats and we're going to answer your questions on Questionable. Holy crap, that was an awesome discussion about video game reviews with Tom, Jada, and Kat. But now we're switching gears. We're going from reviews to refood.
Whoa.
We've got Reb Valentine in the studio.
That was amazing, Seth. Well done.
Thank you. I'm full of it. Sam Claiborne.
Hey, it's so good to be here. Hi.
Hello. And Miranda Sanchez.
Hi, hello.
Welcome. It's so great to see you both. You have neither one of you have been on the show in ages and ages, and we're really excited to have you here. We're going to be doing a little question block. Excuse me, a little Quebston long.
Quebston block.
But, Reb.
I went over my head.
It's
a thing.
He put in the show doc, he started writing Quebston block in the show document instead of question block. And nobody noticed until I was hosting just for him 1 week when he wasn't here. And I got to the question block segment and I opened my mouth as I was looking at it and went, now it's time for Quebston Blanc, because I didn't understand what he had done. Okay. So we've been calling it that. It's not actually that funny of a joke, but I don't
know. No, it's a thing now. We're going to merchandise it. So look for that t-shirt in the IGN store as soon as possible.
I want it on a Thanksgiving colored poncho.
Yeah, that's okay. You know, who doesn't?
What?
Are you talking like a rain poncho, or are you talking like a woven?
Oh, no,
like...
way. Woven poncho all the way. Can you imagine a rain poncho? No, that's so gosh.
I have a friend
like
he lives
three
in
times.
Yeah.
He lives in Arizona, and he sent me a picture. He has he's like 6'7", 300 pounds. He's a large man, and he has one of those little mini bikes. Mm-hmm. And he sent me a picture of him on his mini bike with a poncho, and it was maybe the most powerful image I've
that's
ever
really,
seen.
See, that's
I've
the
seen
only way
life.
To get to Bookman's.
Yeah.
This is an Arizona reference for just me and Seth.
Yeah, that's right. Or we could go to Zia Records maybe
yes,
when we're done
if
at
there are any left.
I'm so glad you're here, Sam.
I don't think so. Hey, Reb.
Yeah.
You got a plate in front of you for those who are just listening. There's a plate in front of you.
Yes.
And it looks like there's something on that plate. Could you explain to the listeners at home?
Yeah, absolutely. So we're doing a Thanksgiving episode where people tend to eat at Thanksgiving. So I wanted to make something food related because I've made food to bring on this podcast before from various video game cookbooks. Mm-hmm. And my cowardly admission is that actually I forgot that I had promised to do this until this morning when my alarm went off at 5:30.
Come on, you baked this morning?
I did bake this morning. And I panicked because I wanted to make something from the Legend of Zelda cookbook because you two both did like so much work on the guides for Breath of the Wild and Tears of the Kingdom.
We both did a lot.
Both involved. Yeah. Heavily involved in guides work. And I thought having a Zelda food would be appropriate. And so I remembered that having committed to this, I drowned my Zelda cookbook on accident in water when I was
soaking
lentils.
Did you shoot awake and be like, I'm supposed to cook something?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, actually the alarm went off. I had Pokemon sleep. I had the alarm in that. I looked at it and I went, oh, I
should
actually
have had Pokemon awake. That was your problem.
I can't hit snooze.
Were you
going to
cook
up
it the night before?
I was originally going to make Turtle Rock cookies from that book, which is a recipe I took a photo of, like little pecans and chocolate, little turtle shaped.
I remember seeing a picture of that in
They're
that cookbook.
They're super cute, and I really want to make them. And I took a picture of that recipe when I drowned my cookbook because I hadn't made it yet, and I wanted to make
it. What are you saying? You drowned your cookbook?
I drowned it. It was sitting on the counter. I was soaking some lentils for an unrelated thing. It overflowed, and the thing just got covered in water, and I tried to dry it out, but I didn't dry it out fast enough, so it got moldy in the pages.
No.
I could never eat soaked lentils again.
No. It wasn't good. I was going to go to the store. I was going to buy the ingredients for this, and then I was going to make them this morning, but I forgot to go to the store. So I had to make something with what I had, and I didn't have any recipes in that. Anyway, the point is, I looked up the IGN guide for recipes in Tears of the Kingdom.
Mm-hmm. You got goat butter.
Oh. I got goat butter.
You got Tabantha wheat.
But I found nut cake is in there. And this actually is in the Legends cookbook. Oh. But I didn't use the Legends cookbook recipe. Mm-hmm. I used just sort of a combination of knowing how to make coffee cake-like breads, banana bread and things like that, and the things that I had. So it does have raisins in it. It also has almonds for the nut cake part. It has vanilla and various spices. So it smells like Christmas in here a little bit.
It really does.
It's my God, I'm so envious.
Really nice. As soon as she put it in front of us, I was like, this smells great.
Well, I really hope it tastes as good as it smells. I'm just very nervous about
it. Fruitcake essence of smell, which is like, that's what the holiday spices are like.
Yeah, like nutmeg in there, really good stuff. I did not make it with Hylian acorns, which I believe are involved in nut cake somehow.
It's interchangeable, depending on the
with
nut.
With Chicaloo nut or Hylian something.
Oh my gosh. Of course, like obviously you have retained this information.
Let me tell you.
I've never had in real life goat butter. I've had lots of goat cheeses, but it looks so good in Zelda that I'm like super goat butter curious now.
Yeah, it's like melting stuff. What I really wish I would have done, if I had had, this week has been very chaotic, but if I had more time and energy this week, what I would have done is done a cheesy recipe or like the pizza recipe.
Oh yeah.
In Tears of the Kingdom, like that's one of the really notable
new
ones. They have this whole side quest where you basically help someone reinvent
rig an election.
You rig an election.
Isn't that the same thing? Isn't that the election quest?
Yeah, it's part of that. Yeah. Because you're trying to win the favor of the people, and then you come across this family that's like, we need to do something else with our milk. And there's my grandpa has this long lost recipe that's somehow just floating in the middle of this lake. Can you go get it? And then you do.
It's
and then
an it's extensive like, quest too. It takes a long time.
But it's really goofy because the idea that no one in this village where like dairy is clearly a primary export can remember cheese. It's not that they've never, it's never happened there before, but at some point someone invented cheese. And then what is it? Isn't it part of the quest? Like they had to like ban it or suppress it or something? Or
no, I think they just, I forget exactly what.
A lot of calories. In cheese.
How do you forget about it,
though? How can you forget cheese, really?
Well, and then there's also this other subplot in the game about tomatoes being really hip.
Oh, yeah.
So, and, like, you know, the description says that. And, like, people sometimes talk about tomatoes in the game. And, like, it's a new thing. And you see them in the sky for the first time. But I think you can get them in other places. But so that's the other component of pizza, which you just, like, you just think of them, like, being like, well, we want to put pizza in this game. And then they, like, totally retconned every single ingredient and made it, like, part of the game. It's so cool.
Yeah. I do really like the sort of thought experiment of, okay, if tomorrow a bunch of floating islands appeared in the sky here in our world, and then some of them crashed to the ground, and we looked at them, and suddenly we realized they were covered in like new plant species we had never seen before, trees, mushrooms, fruits, things like that we'd never seen before, immediately we would have culinary discoveries.
Yeah.
Like, not forget everything else involved with that, with like archaeology and science and stuff. People would be like ripping up plants and going, can we eat any of this?
I feel bad thinking immediately of like, are these invasive species?
Oh,
what's it gonna kill off? Like, are Hylian tomatoes invasive?
Like, we're gonna find out tomorrow that like the silent princess has gone completely extinct because it was choked out by the sundalions or something.
That's what I was thinking too. I was like,
those look like they taste bad though, so I'm cool with it.
Yeah, no. They make you glow. That's that's not good.
Maybe in a tropical cocktail.
Yeah.
Back to pizza though. I tried it. So the first time I was making pizza in that game.
I'm gonna eat this while we talk. I'm really hungry.
Oh yeah.
I was hoping that everyone could take like a bite and give their thoughts.
Okay, we can do that.
I want to hear the pizza story though.
No, it's fine. Let's
do this first.
Yeah,
I want to hear the pizza story.
If we have time for pizza, we will have time for pizza.
That's true. It's always time for pizza. Don't you remember? Have you not ever been to a Pizza Hut in the 80s? There was a clock. It literally said, it's time for pizza. And it just ran very fast. And one of the hands, I believe, was a pizza cutter, and the other was a spatula.
Oh. I think it tastes all right. I think it's a little dry because of the nuts.
A little dry.
Good. Oh.
I don't remember that. I want one of those clocks so bad.
I scour. Every time I go into a thrift store, I look for a Pizza Hut classic. There it is. It's always time for pizza.
Oh,
I was wrong about
That's it.
I was wrong about the hands, but... yeah, every Pizza Hut had one of those, and the glass lamps, which go for like $1,500.
Well, those are great. Like the kind that you'd put over your pool table.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yes. Yep.
Yeah, those are amazing. Yep. Like those in every iteration, whether they're beer or Pizza Hut, are really cool, and they're always really expensive.
Yep. Our local Thai restaurant.
An antique place in Kansas City has had a bunch of those.
Oh, wow.
Oh, nice.
Oh, it's more of a
so what's the verdict on the bread?
Hmm.
It's very holiday-like, and it would be really good with a nice cup of what's coffee in Zelda?
They have coffee?
They have anything like
they
that?
They don't really...
Animal Crossing.
Zelda aren't great, I would say.
No.
Like, there's not really a lot of options.
They have water and moo-moo milk. Lawn milk.
Okay.
Universe is crossed.
So maybe a lawn latte.
The alcohol.
Drink. Yeah, which is non-alcoholic, technically, but we
the Noble Pursuit?
Yeah. You can pretend it has alcohol, even though it's in a cocktail glass. It's not technically alcoholic.
I see. I think this would be good if they served it at a milk bar.
Yeah.
I also think it would be good with like coffee.
Yeah. I'd want like more milk with it.
I mean,
now that you make in Zelda.
Yes. Now that you've mentioned coffee cake, it's all I can think about. So this is it.
Yeah. This is a coffee cake recipe.
Yeah.
Basically.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So it's great. Sam. I want to hear about some pizza.
Oh, back to pizza. So when I first was making pizza, my whole goal in Tears of the Kingdom, like I didn't want to beat the game or anything. I just wanted to make the pizza. So I got it. That's just a joke, everybody.
Speed running category.
Please hold your emails. But I was doing those quests, and this is pretty recent because that game, you know, I've been playing for months and months and months. And so I got all the ingredients. I finally got the cheese, and I was like, this is going to be great. And I was like, I didn't want to look up a recipe. So I was like, I'm going to make pizza. And so I did... You know, I think it's just tomato, cheese, and then wheat is what you're supposed to do. That's it.
Sounds right.
But because the wheat looks like the rice in the menu, I used rice. And I did it like, I wasted like 10 cheeses being like, what the F is wrong? Do I need to add mushrooms? Do I need to add like a topping? Like this is, you know, I didn't want to look it up. So I was like, what's going on here? And it was like, I was making like gooey, crappy rice pizza, but gluten-free.
There you go.
Yeah, the rice and the wheat do look too similar. Mm-hmm. I've made that mistake many times experimenting.
Yeah, otherwise you get, instead of like cool rice bowls, you get porridge. Yeah. I think it's like usually what the distinction is, which is like, you know, a nice Hyrule bass porridge doesn't sound as tasty as a, you know, fishy rice bowl.
No. There's a lot of stuff in there that is not explicitly dubious food, but seems like it would be quite dubious. Like there's all the dark recipes that also came in Tears of the Kingdom. I don't know. Some of those like dark soup. I don't know.
I want them. I want them all.
Yeah. What do you think they taste like?
That's what I was thinking too. It's like, what's the flavor profile here? And I think they would be, they wouldn't be spicy. I think they'd be kind of like mild and rich in flavor.
Because Goron spice is spicy in the game, right? And then they kind of had that as the spicy thing. But like they do, there is something about that, like that I don't know if it's supposed to be like really umami or like sour, because like the recipes are like really diverse that you can make with
it. I guess I also just said mild and rich, but mild isn't like heat. Like they wouldn't be a hot thing, but they would have very deep flavors.
It's really hard to get that element until pretty mid game, late game.
Honestly, I feel like they would be like mole a little bit.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
Yeah, okay. Like a chocolate.
Yeah, chocolate spicy, but not sweet.
Ooh. Yeah.
I like imagining that it tastes like, so we have like sweet, sour, salty, bitter, umami. I like imagining that it's a sixth taste.
Yeah.
That we don't know.
We don't even know.
Can't imagine it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, do you see where those things come from? Yeah. Like the dirt.
And then,
things pulsing, it's weird.
And that's a different category than monster recipes.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And like monster cake and everything. What makes them the purple or monster rice ball? What's the thing you add to that? Do you actually add a monster part?
The essence.
Oh, right. The liquid. Yeah.
You can't just have a part. The part will like make you
distill it into a elixir first.
It's a secret process that we do not know.
Right.
But the process has been passed on to, I forget what his name is in.
The little guy.
Yeah.
Yep.
The
dude whose brother wants to be a magic.
No, not Colton and Kilton. Like they passed on the recipe to a merchant.
Oh.
In how can I forget the name of this place? Because I listened
Tarrytown?
To Tarrytown. Yeah,
well, because
like the
there's 1 million things to do.
It's
in
true.
Oh, right. Game. Yeah.
So in Tarrytown, there is a Rito merchant who now sells it exclusively. So
a Rito. Interesting.
Yeah. I'm sure he's a Rito. I'm like,
I mostly just made skewers. Like I was playing the game and exploring. I was just like, all right, we got mushrooms, we got fruits, we got.
Oh yeah.
You see, the way I play is like, Link needs a nice treat. He's about to go into battle. He's getting a feast, and then we have dessert prepared for later. That's how I play. I'm like, no.
That is amazing.
It's all about the role play.
You know, we were talking about turbo buttons before this, but the best turbo button in Zelda, Tears of the Kingdom, and in Breath of the Wild is to make money by hunting and making meat skewers. And the recipe for that is you kill as many. There's no rhinos. Did you notice that in Tears of the Kingdom? But you go up to Tabantha Snowfield, kill as many moose as possible, but you got to get in close. So you got to be on a horse usually. And then because the meat will freeze and then it becomes a cooked thing. It's like frozen meat.
Yep.
So you get all your dropped meat and then you go take the big prime cuts and you make skewers and you cook them. So for people that are trying to make money, you can go and sell those for like the high-end ones is like 450 or something, I think, rupees. And then the mid ones are like 200 something. It's like the most rewarding way to make money.
Yeah, but they also will restore like 12 hearts or something just on
you
own.
Could eat them, but you know, you could also buy rare armor or something. It's a difficult decision.
True.
Sometimes you're in a pickle and you're like, I can't eat my money, so try to sell your money stuff first.
You could get a lot of money and then you could wear the armor that when you get attacked you don't lose hearts, you lose rupees.
That armor is wild
and you're basically invincible.
But I'll have to look this up, because in Breath of the Wild there was a better way to make money, which was bowling, but it wasn't as fun as hunting. And, and as far as I can tell, this is still the best way without item duplication to make money in the game is to hunt, which is
One of the hard things too, though, is that your arrows are so precious. Mm-hmm. And I have run out of arrows like several times, which is shocking. I was I had like 100 something. How did I run out?
I know.
Because like, you're like farming or you're just like killing.
Once you get out of the psychological like zone of like, I need to be conserving my arrows, you use them really fast.
Yeah.
It's such great human psychology. Look at us. We're all talking about Tears of the Kingdom.
Yeah.
It's only the best game of the year. Yeah. So why wouldn't we talk about it?
Well,
months later. Maybe
democracy
one of these
will
days
reveal if that's true or not, Seth.
I mean, democracy is an imperfect system because, you know, it will sometimes reward tyranny. And if what I'm saying is if Tears of the Kingdom doesn't win, it's a tyrannical decision.
Tyrannies of the kingdom.
Of the masses. Yes, exactly. Well, now that everyone's eaten and I'm just sitting here by myself.
I'm sorry.
No, it's fine.
I'll mail you a loaf.
Do you want to mail me a loaf? That's the next t-shirt and the IGN shirt. Mail me a loaf. Let's get to some questions. Questions. Webston Block questions. Ben Fisk, top contributor, asks, why are you guys so down on the Zelda movie? And this is a common, people were pretty upset with us that we weren't all stoked on the Zelda movie. And now that the dust has settled, and we've all had a little bit of time to be, oh my God, is that Peppers?
Yeah, just
I'm sorry.
Into the studio.
Peppers just appeared.
Yeah, we had a dog
so
invasion.
Not only do you have food, but you have IGN's most famous dog, Pepper Scoville. Pepper's little Peepaw there. Peepaw is really excited for the Zelda movie.
Yes.
So next time we have a look, I'm just going to say that I think in future discussions, we'll probably all be a little less off the cuff. Like we were fired up.
We were.
You know, like Logan, that guy, he just slow down, you know, he's crazy. No, that's not true. Logan is wonderful.
We love Logan.
I don't know. It's hard to be optimistic when they say live action. Sorry, I don't want to like retread too much, but.
No,
like,
I would love to have some support because the community was not happy that we weren't thrilled.
So they did a good job with the Mario movie, but they had like a studio and a team associated that knows how to do that kind of comedy, that humor, that animation. But right now we just have a guy who did some okay adaptions of YA novels and that have been received in various ways and is doing a Planet of the Apes, which it's like, okay, maybe he's good at like CG directing and other stuff, or CGI, excuse me. I have nothing else to give confidence here. Like, it's just, I'm very worried that this is going to be YA Marvel, which, like, very specific. YA Marvel fantasy is what they're kind of going for with the team that they have attached to it right now. And I think that's okay. Like, Zelda's a story for all ages. But the scary part is you're putting a human face to Link.
And a voice.
Yeah,
and
that's
a voice.
Tough. That's for anybody. For even, like, a really... For like the absolute best team in the world.
Look, it's hard to look good in a tunic.
Yeah, that's also true.
You know from experience.
Uh-huh. I have several denim tunics.
Should get a denim utility kilt. Pretty dope.
Yeah.
They sell those at PAX. Absolutely here in San Francisco. There is a utility kilt shop.
I'm going to bring it. Like, yeah, we were giving our initial thoughts, and none of us were psyched. Now, that being said, I have full faith that Mr. Miyamoto, who, by the way, just turned 71. Happy birthday, Mr. Miyamoto. Whoa. He always listens.
Yay.
He listens every
Mr.
week.
Mr. M.
Can I share something about Miyamoto?
Oh, yeah.
This is my favorite thing that we were talking about this morning. I watched a movie with Miyamoto once.
What?
Wait,
it's like
what?
It's like the weirdest way to phrase this. I was in Japan for...
It was Milo and Otis.
Oh, no.
I was in Japan for something very unrelated, but the Detective Pikachu premiere happened to be happening while I was in Japan, and one of our former editors was like, you want to go? And I was like, is that a question? Mm. And so Miyamoto was there, so I'm like, we watched a movie together.
Oh my God.
So
Miyamoto was your movie date. That is amazing. What did he have for snacks? You know. Did you see?
Yeah. I don't think he had any snacks when he came in. Mm. I didn't have any snacks either, to be fair.
They didn't.
I was,
you know,
like,
Mr. Miyamoto seems like the kind of guy who... like everyone would be eating, like going just housing some Twizzlers and some Reese's Pieces. I feel like he would have like a bento box that would, you know, when you opened it up, it was like a faint glow to it because it'd be magic.
So, I think he's a Junior Mints guy.
Yeah.
You think he's a Junior Mints? Junior Mints is a great choice with
really
the popcorn.
Good, yeah.
Oh, yeah. For sure. A quick question that has nothing to do. Has anyone else bitten the end off Twizzlers and drank soda through them?
Ew.
Yeah. You can make them a straw.
I've not done that with Twizzlers. I've done it with sour punch straws. And
no, you've gone too far, Reb.
I will say it's been at least 30 years if I've ever done that.
I think I've done it this year.
The real good one is candy canes with chocolate milk. You can do it with hot chocolate, but the problem is the hot chocolate melts the candy cane and then you burn your mouth because you're through a straw.
If a candy cane, candy canes don't have holes and you don't drink hot things through straws.
It's going down.
This is so confusing.
No, so you drink chocolate milk, not...
Okay.
But they...
Candy canes shouldn't be hollow.
You're right. I don't think they're hollow, but I did this in Girl Scouts once, and it worked.
It's kind of a cool idea to have a maybe candy cane a straw, though.
Stick.
That'd be kind of...
Yeah, peppermint stick, maybe. Maybe, yeah, maybe they do make a peppermint stick.
They make, like, the world's most unhealthy, like, they're straws that are made out of cereal. So you could just drink milk through a cereal straw and then eat the straw.
Yeah.
You know, like the cocoa pebbles.
What do you mean they make?
They. The cereal overlords.
You know what I'm talking about. Them. The deep state. They.
Listen, I get that plastic bag of just a generic brand cereal. I don't know what this is.
Oh, my God. The Malt Meal? It's the best. Yeah, 40 ounces of Fruity Dino Puffs. Fruity Dino Bites, I mean.
We have four kids.
Oh, there it is.
We're not getting this.
Oh my
fancy
God.
Stuff.
Brad just pulled the cereal straw.
Brought to you
look
by
at that.
Was it look at, was it last week that you were saying that a Lucky Charms with all marshmallows would not be good? Was that you?
Ooh. I was saying that the Super Mario movie was a bowl of Lucky Charms with all the oats removed.
Right, yeah. Okay.
Yes.
Which is, he's not saying it's good or bad. He's just saying.
No.
But back to the Zelda movie. Like, look, listen. We had just heard about
look,
it.
Look, I got.
Emotions were high.
I hang out with these guys.
I got so much heat for just saying all the same things that it sounds like you guys said on the podcast last week on Game Scoop. So I'm not touching this one.
Honestly, I thought the consensus was that, like, kind of skeptical. Because live action.
I'm extremely skeptical.
Seems like a poor choice.
No, you don't want to do this, Miranda.
It's fine. Like, I don't, I just feel like they should have waited to announce a little bit more of an exciting either cast around it or more people involved in the writing. Like, obviously Miyamoto's involved in some capacity, but with what they gave us, it's like, this is not the director I thought they would choose for, like, The Legend of Zelda.
Yeah. You know what? I think you've really hit it on the head. I think you're exactly right. I don't think it's that I'm not excited about a Zelda movie. I think great. I'm glad they're doing a Zelda movie. It's not that I think live action is impossible to do well. It's not that I hate anyone involved. It's just a weird way to find out. And it's very, and with the information we've been given, it's hard to visualize the specific combination of things in a way that is pleasing to me.
Okay, well, I was taught to, if you can't say anything nice, to not say anything. No. Here's a backhanded way to do this.
Oh my gosh.
Will force Nintendo's hand to put out a Zelda game that year.
Okay.
Oh, hell yeah.
There's nothing bad about that.
See, I did it. Now I'm excited, everybody. Now I'm excited hell for the year the Zelda movie comes out.
I want it to be
Zelda,
Wind
Waker. The movie, the game.
Yeah.
Does Big Mary have anything nice to say?
Twilight Princess.
That's probably would be one of the best ones to adapt.
Yeah,
actually.
It'd be really moody and cool. That's great for YA.
Oh my God. Okay. Yeah. No, Miranda, that absolutely. Like, I want a moody, like, goth Zelda. That's what I want.
Mm-hmm.
So
interesting.
That's what I want too.
I think they would have, I'm going into skepticism. I think that's, like, the most obvious one to turn into live action because it's already sort of the closest to a more realistic-ish looking thing. But also, how do you do Midna and Wolf Link?
What do you mean? How do you do them?
That could be CGI. That's easy enough.
Okay.
Midna is Danny DeVito.
I hope they look good in CG.
I think they can.
Like, they say can.
The guy directing is doing Planet of the Apes stuff.
Like, yeah, I'm not saying they can't.
That movie looks
good. They've got some
deal.
Or as we talked a little bit about on last week's show, Jim Henson's Creature Shop, and maybe, like, Weta. Do the effects,
cool.
Like the creature effects. That'd be badass. There, I'm gonna say that.
Mm-hmm.
If they do practical creature effects like Jim Henson's Creature Shop, like, I would be 1,000% on board.
That would be a very cool surprise.
And I love Labyrinth.
Are we worried that Miyamoto has been working on this ever since Wii Music, and that's all he's done this century?
Oh, that would be heartbreaking.
Just a joke.
You get a vitality sensor when you buy a ticket to the movie. So
I hope that if we go to the movie and bring the Nintendo Labo, like, goggles or whatever, we can get 3D effects.
That'd be sweet. 3D, boy, that came and went, didn't it? I don't have depth perception, but 3D movies was the only time I could experience the world in three dimensions. And now I can't anymore. Thanks a lot.
Really?
Thanks for nothing. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
I don't have depth perception, but when I went to see, like, whatever that Jurassic World movie is, the one where he goes like that.
Yeah.
I could see that in 3D. It wasn't very good 3D, but it was still
that's cool.
Pretty exciting to go from a 2D.
It was
world.
Like the train was coming right at you.
It was coming right at me. Mark Schlasner asks, Which PS4, Xbox One games would you like to see ported to the Super Nintendo Switch? So in a hypothetical world where the next Switch comes out and we get
last generation games on it,
Xbox
what? Ported to them. This is a very rude question. This is a rude question.
What games are on the PS4?
I know, it's not, because right off the rip, I want to be able to play Red Dead Redemption 2 on the go, and I want to be able to play Metal Gear Solid 5.
Switch.
No. But like in like really good resolution. So that's my.
All right. Well, maybe you'll get to play a new Zelda 5. Game and a 5-year-old Red Dead game the same year.
I will play. Red Dead is like one of the best games ever made. I love
it too.
So
but you know, come on.
And I would want to play it on the go. The Steam Deck changed my approach to Grand Theft Auto 5. I mean, I love Grand Theft Auto 5. I played hundreds of hours. But when I got my Steam Deck, I was like, oh, this is an incredible portable game. So.
You know what'd be cool instead?
I guess I could.
Instead.
instead of old last gen games on a new console, like two times removed, can we get maybe like the next Dragon Age? Because that'd be really cool. That's what I'd want.
That's not the question.
I'm sorry.
I have an actual answer.
You'll get Dragon Age 3.
Okay.
And you'll like it.
I have an actual answer. I'm pretty sure this was on PS4. And so, of course, it's not going to be, and someone in the comments is going to yell at me. I'm sorry if it's not actually on PS4. I want.
Wow, you're a professional. Journalist, and you don't know this?
I don't remember what is on every. I don't memorize this stuff. I research because I'm a reporter. I look it up.
Hell yeah. Oh my God. That's such a ball of
good answer. That was a good answer right there.
I want Tales of Zestiria.
Okay.
I know that's like a weird answer. I really liked Tales of Zestiria. A lot of other people don't like it. A lot of people are really into
pre-Symphonia.
No, it's post. It's the weird
like a PS4 game.
It came out like. Somewhere in the realm of, I think Vesperia was right after it or something, but it wasn't like as well loved. Like it had things that people didn't like about it, but I actually liked it a lot. I thought it was really good. I thought the music was really, really cool. I thought the cast was really good. I thought it had some interesting twists, and I didn't finish it. I played it on PC and I don't remember why I didn't finish it. I think I was having trouble like with my controller or something because I had an old PC then. But it was like on PC and PS4, and it hasn't like been put on. Like, a lot of the other Tales games have gotten love and gotten moved to other platforms, but yeah. Zestiria is just kind of languishing. And yeah, okay, whatever. Bring me that. I'll play that, sure.
I'm trying really hard to think about any games on Xbox One or PS4 that I could possibly want to play on Switch. And I'm really having a hard time because, like, a lot of the older games I'd want to revisit, like Titanfall 2, that's not going to be fun on a Switch controller. Like, shooters are not, like, super precise Switch. Not. Like, shooters, that's not great. And the other ones are, like, exclusives. So it's kind of...
Is Red trying to suggest something? What is this?
Astro
that we're looking at.
Isn't this the Astro?
I'm just gonna go.
Oh, this is Astro. Astro's Playground.
Oh, is that on PS5?
Yeah.
Yeah. This is
doesn't count.
This is a great
Red.
Game. It's not
so it's like an impossible question. I don't know the last time I really thought about PS4
no,
or Xbox One.
I haven't thought.
You know
about
what
it.
I would love? You know what I would love to come to Switch? The next Switch would be the Final Fantasy VII Remake and Rebirth games.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
I started playing that again. I bounced right off of it when it came out, and then I played it with the PlayStation Portal, and I actually really love that stupid game for all of its dumbness. Yeah, it's great. I'm having a great
Hell
time.
House,
and
Hell
I'm looking
house,
forward
Hell
to how ridiculous.
Hell House.
All right, I'll just be nice to this writer and say Cyberpunk.
Okay.
That'd be a good one too.
Sure,
But specifically the PlayStation 4 version that has no textures and runs it at four frames per second.
That I believe people got refunds for.
That was like a chaotic evil answer, Sam.
I know. I thought it was pretty good.
Skyrim. I was like Skyrim into. On this.
Skyrim. Look, if they're like, we got a new Skyrim and it's in 4K, I'd be like, well, here's my money. For the eighth time,
is it not
I
in 4K?
Probably
right
is it. Yeah. What
I mean, on a new Switch hardware,
but like nice cleaned up one with smooth edges and stuff, right?
Yeah.
I mean, modders do that, but it'd be nice to get an official one.
Yeah.
Well, all right. We have time, real quick, for one last question, and this one is from Tyler Dipple, and this is kind of mostly a question for me because he says, where is it? It's a long question. I'm about to move into a new house. Eventually, I'd like to finish the basement and turn a portion of it into a dedicated home office game room. If I'm not mistaken, you keep most of your games and computers into your basement office, right? Yeah, right behind me. All that stuff. I don't have my modern stuff, though. My PS5, my Xbox, my Switch, my Steam Deck, they're all upstairs. But this is all my classic stuff. And Tyler is worried about moisture getting in and ruining all of this stuff. Wants to know if I have any issues with mold or moisture in my basement office. And if so, what do you do about it? I did. One time my basement flooded. I had to get a new desk because it ruined a lot of things.
No.
The reason that happened was because my town didn't have good drainage. And then now they do. So I just run a dehumidifier. If you are going to put your stuff in your basement, absolutely run a dehumidifier constantly, because you that moisture, you don't notice it, but it creeps up. Before when this used to just be where we stored stuff, I would come down here and I'd find like
excellent B-roll.
It's got a
I love like, Red. What is this B-roll so much?
What is this B-roll?
I think it's household implements.
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay. Yeah, like, but for real, like if you want to set stuff up in your basement, you got to keep the moisture out. Sam, you have like a million and one like classic things. How do you keep them from getting
destroyed? Well, there's two situations. One is that I have stuff in a garage, and there I have to make sure that the salty sea air, because we're only a couple miles from the ocean anywhere in San Francisco. If you're nearer to the ocean, you have a lot more problems with that. I don't necessarily in my house, but I've been worried about that for years, and so I've kind of made it a little bit, I finished the garage basically. I wanted to add, your electronics for moisture, like until it gets like basically underwater, you're probably okay. But it can rust things if things are susceptible to rust. So if you have, things that might have, that's what you have to worry about. But your kind of electronic components within something, you're probably going to be okay with. However, what I wanted to point out is if you're displaying your old games, you need to be aware of sun and light damage. So fluorescent lights and incandescent lights, and I don't know about LEDs as much, but in the sun, anything coming into a room will fade your reds in your NES game labels and your boxes. You will not realize it's happening. You'll pull them out and they'll be pink and crappy looking. All that ink from the 80s is now given up the ghost. It's just like Super Nintendo's turning yellow. And collectors need to be careful. And you'll also see this in Xbox 360 and Wii games, the spines, if you have them exposed to any type of light, they will fade. And that ink is going. It just took 10 years for some of these things, but after that, it's gone. So like you will ruin your games if you have them displayed, unfortunately. So you need to lock them away in drawers and Tupperwares like I do, and then they just will never be seen again. I own them.
I have one
I'll give you
piece.
Another piece of advice before we end this segment. If you ever buy like clothes or get stuff in a package, they come with silica, and I keep all these from every package I've ever owned, and I just throw them in.
Oh, I eat them immediately.
A box of games. Well, it says do not eat, but that's again the deep state not wanting you to
keep them away from your pets.
Keep them away from
your pets. Straws out of that stuff.
Mm-hmm. Well,
do we have time? I have one.
We don't have time.
Oh,
I've never
keep your stuff off the floor.
Yeah, there's bugs.
There's ratzos.
Oh yeah.
If your basement floods, just lift it up.
I learned that
I've never had a basement before.
Yeah,
they're scary. Oh.
I have a ground floor.
I don't want to be.
I'm from Kansas.
I'm from Texas.
Yeah, I'm from Maine. We have basements because otherwise your house would just float away on the mud.
A tornado will hit me.
You got to put that heating oil somewhere.
That is also true. I have 300 gallons of heating oil like right over there.
What? But
I learned about this from Seth.
Thank you for coming in and enjoying some food without me. I appreciate you all. Reb, Sam, and Miranda, thank you all for coming in. And we have one more segment. We're going to go right to... We're going to talk about that Zelda trailer that you might have seen 15 years ago. So, of course, last week, the Legend of Zelda movie was announced. That's a long ways off from now. Go back and watch last week's episode for our thoughts. But did you know that 15 years ago, IGN had its own trailer for a Zelda movie? It was an April Fool's joke, and people were really mad. And, of course, now we have a new group of Ninfriendos at the studio desk to talk about it. We've got Jada, we've got Kat, and we've got Pear, who was there, which is your new nickname now, Pear, who was there. So Pear, could you give us a little bit of a history, a little bit of background behind this now kind of legendary Legend of Zelda trailer?
Pear was there, that's right. I mean, all credit should really go to Sam Balcom, the filmmaker who made that trailer. Basically, at the time, this is like 2006, 2007, IGN was investing in video content. We were looking for creators who would do some cool stuff. We've got like superhero fan fight videos from that day to show. If you go to the IGN Games YouTube channel and scroll all the way back, you see a lot of that content. And as part of that, we decided to invest in Sam, who pitched us on a fan trailer for a Zelda game. So he didn't ever want to make a movie featuring the Zelda characters. He just wanted to do a trailer to showcase what it could be like. And he was really good at special effects. His dad's a Hollywood composer. Had connections to Hollywood. There's some actors that are actually in that trailer that people might recognize. And he came to us and we're like, let's support this project. Let's put some money in, and then we'll see where it goes, and we'll figure out how we present it on IGN. And then he shows us an early version of the trailer, and we watched it together. Fran Mirabella at the time, set it up in our demo room to watch on a big screen. And we're all sitting there, and we're like, you got to be kidding me. It's way too good. I mean, when you see it with modern eyes, you're like, okay, this is obviously, this is fan made. Some of the costumes or the makeup doesn't look like Hollywood blockbuster material, but the special effects for the time were really, really good. And so I said, this is too good to post as a fan trailer. Let's be mean about it, and let's hold this for April 1st. And we pitched that to Sam. Sam said, okay, let's do it. And So he kept on working on it. The music was added. It's got custom music based on the Zelda themes, and he added a Dodongo shot and pea hats flying around. Everything, pretty freaking awesome work. And then we added a fake like credit screen at the end, a chime that appears when it says it comes out on April 1st, just to make it sure that there's some hints that it's fake. And then we held it till April Fool's, and we posted it at midnight, and we went like this and hit the button to publish it. We didn't upload it to YouTube at the time. We actually posted it later on YouTube because we were worried about copyright strikes. Mm-hmm. We were worried that Nintendo would be really pissed, so we just debuted it on the website. And it went up, and like the comments were, "Oh my god, I can't wait for it," or "Oh, I don't like how Ganondorf looks in this. I hate this. Don't do this to us, Nintendo." Still, the occasional people saying like, "Wait a second, that it says April 1st. This must be a joke, right?" But the majority of the feedback was either, "I can't believe this is happening," or "This is not what I want." And then, we came clean the next day, and we said it was an April Fool's joke, and we became the most hated people in the world for a very, very long time. Honestly, we got so many emails about that trailer years after saying, "You made my child cry. You're the worst people in the world. I cannot believe this is not real. Why would you do that to us?" I have no excuse.
A lot of broken hearts pair.
Yeah.
I was at a tiki bar a couple months ago, and it came up that I worked at IGN, and they're like, "Oh, I'm a big fan of yours." I was like, "Of your guys'." And like, he's like, "But I still haven't forgiven you guys for that one video." I'm like, "Which video?" He's like, the video."
Yeah,
and I'm like,
"Be more specific."
I was like, "I don't know.
You know the one, Jada."
And he's like the Zelda one. I'm like, "Oh, yeah, I wasn't involved in that." Oh, so, still give me some good drinks. But
it's really funny. Like, if you look at the feedback today, people go like, "Well, of course you can tell it's fake, right?" It's a little bit like talking about the very first film performances where people were scared that a train would hit them by coming out of the screen. And like, when I was a kid and I saw Jurassic Park, I was like, "This is real. This is as real as it's ever going to get." And now you watch it, you see some of the CG when the T-Rex is running is not perfect, right? And the sneeze is not very good. But like, at the time, people totally fell for it. And people will go like, "Well, I always knew it was fake." Come on.
It looks great too.
The other thing that happens with every April Fool's joke is people saying, "This is obviously fake. This is the worst April Fool's joke you've made." And then a year later, the comments change to, "This is the best April Fool's joke of all time. This is the best." So this has happened with Halo Bollywood, where people were really mad at us. That's an awesome trailer still. It's happened with, we did a fake GTA trailer, a fake Auras Harry Potter trailer. So we've got a bunch of them. And even the Nintendo Direct, where it's
Everything's
coming to Switch.
So many of those came true too.
Initial reactions was like, "This is the worst. This is obviously fake." It's like, no, duh.
Like,
what? It's almost like an April Fool's joke.
Halo Bollywood is
Halo
so good.
Bollywood. When I look back at that Zelda live action trailer, I think about the obvious Lord of the Rings influences.
Yeah.
But it works surprisingly well, actually.
You gotta remember this was the time where Legend of Zelda went into more of a Lord of the Ringsy direction, right? Like if you look at
Twilight Princess,
the trailer and mm-hmm. the game, obviously riding on, you know, wild boars that look like wargs from the movies and all of that. So the Nintendo design team definitely was inspired by Peter Jackson stuff. And so yeah, this one definitely went into that same direction. But it's pretty fun to see that it's had legs this long, and the views on it, we don't have records, unfortunately, going back to 2008. Like our tracking tools like Google Analytics change every so often and you lose some of your data, but the numbers were insane. And you know, we posted it late on YouTube and it's got a couple of million views there as well. Yeah, it was just such a fun experiment, and I think Sam was happy with it. Like I think partially it's like, well, you know, like pretending that we never said this, but it was never designed to be an April Fool's joke, right? It mm-hmm. was meant to showcase his abilities and also celebrate Zelda fandom, and so some of that may have gotten lost because it was presented as a trick, but he did a bunch of other fan trailers afterwards. He did a Metroid one with Jess Chobot. He did a commercial for IGN with Attack Sailor Pacific. I don't know if you guys ever saw it. Mm-hmm. It ran in movie theaters. We had a partnership with movie theaters.
Yes.
It's like basically it's around IGN being the best destination to help you decide what game to buy. And there's like a shot of like a CG snake biting somebody when they try to grab this game from under a bed. It's like Sam is a madman. He's just so good at this stuff. It's great.
What's he doing now?
He's doing Hollywood stuff.
Oh wow!
So, yeah, nice. he's working in the
moving
business.
On up in the world.
Yeah, like commercial work and all of that. Yeah,
that's crazy.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. Wow!
Is this the best of the fan trailers?
Is this the best of the fan trailers?
Yeah.
That we made, or that's
number one.
The number one fan trailer. I mean, there's some really cool stuff. Like somebody did a really cool Majora's Mask one. Remember that mm-hmm. one? Like
those I think, yeah, no, it was the guys who did Kena, Bridge of Spirits.
Yeah.
They did the Majora's Mask short. That was really good.
Yeah, there's so much creative stuff on YouTube, and obviously the landscape blew up, and, you know, the corridor people do awesome stuff all the time, too. Mm-hmm. So.
And now the next logical step is somebody needs to recreate the April Fool's Zelda trailer in Unreal 5, and then the circle.
Ooh.
We've
come full circle.
Pear, thank you for telling us a little bit of history today from the Pear Was There segment, which is now a thing that we're going to do.
Pear Was There.
Remember when the train came at people out of
right,
the street?
Remember?
Yeah, Pear Was There.
But we sure had a lot of fun today getting together with old friends, having a laugh or two, enjoying the thankful season of thanks. And for all you Ninfriendos out there in Ninfriendo land, I'm wishing you a bountiful harvest and a cornucopia filled with various root vegetables, winter squashes, and other seasonal delights. The autumn season. Now I've got to get back to my own Thanksgiving preparations. Those turkeys are not going to slaughter themselves, and I still need to shine the buckle on my pilgrim hat. So, from all of us to all of you, please, please remember, Nintendo Voice Chat is the only place where you can
get the thing.
Get it.
Get the thing.